Let's just treat this video as having a chat. No particular topic or destination to get to, not necessary. Sort of a potpourri, a grab bag of various topics will come up. I find this is really the best way to proceed. A lot of freedom there. Not locked into trying to grab a hold of any definite conclusions along a certain line of reasoning, okay? First of all, in the world right now, what's the situation? So the fact is, we now live in what's called global corporate fascism. The planet is a fascistic planet. Even right now, as I'm speaking, this is not something that is going to happen. It has already happened. It will become much more intense, but it's already happened. Fascism is the marriage of corporations and government. Okay, and government serving the interests, corporate interests, and interests of materialism, a vast bureaucracy that serves the purpose of the corporate political fascism. You have to say Happy Holidays now. You can't say Merry Christmas. That was instituted by corporations, afraid of being sued by special interest groups. That's just one little example, but it's an important example. Because anything so incredibly important to the planet as saying Merry Christmas, in other words, greeting people, is basically saying, I recognize that what you really are is Christ, our spirit, our pure awareness, whatever you want to call it. It's the time of the year you greet people that way. You say, Merry Christmas, meaning I love and respect what you really are. I know you're not this person suffering and dying here on this in this world. And now that's been knocked out. You can't say that anymore. You have to say Happy Holidays, which means nothing. What it really means is have a happy time consuming all these material trinkets. So when fascism is able to knock out the acknowledgement that what we really are is Christ, Spirit, Son of God, then you know you're living in a fascism. You're living under fascism, which is not really life at all. Another fact, biological life, quote-unquote life, is not really life at all. It's really death. That's a fact. True life is not based on energy or chemistry or anything like that. It's essence. There's no process involved in actual life. Life is eternal. What dies was never alive in the first place, was never life in the first place. Okay, another topic that's just very important. There seems to be a global spiritual conceptual belief system now that comes out of non-dualism that answers the question, what's the purpose of life? And the answer always seems to come back something along the lines of, well, God is playing a game of hide and seek with itself. That God forgot itself and fragmented itself for the purpose of remembering itself. And it's all just a game that God is playing with itself. Okay. You hear that over and over and over. What is the purpose of life? People ask these teachers, these gurus, how come God did this crazy thing of all this misery and suffering and death? And the guru will say, well, God is just playing a game with itself, you know. Or they say, well, it's all just arising from mysteriously, spontaneously, just arising, all of this. These various answers. None of those answers are true. Okay? I've never believed those answers for a second in this life, because I have a much, much clearer answer to all of this. But it involves the understanding that reality is a trinity. And you never hear that in the non-dual teachings. But it's extremely important to understand there's God, the prime creator, and then the prime creation is God the Son, or Spirit, or Christ, or Krishna, or Buddha, whatever you want to call it, pure awareness. That is an extension of God, the prime creator, but it is not the prime creator itself. So pure awareness is not the first principle. It's an extension of the first principle. And this extension of the first principle of God, the prime creator, wanted to be prime creator, wanted to be the first principle. It's like Christ wants to be God the prime creator. And this idea, this whim, is what is giving rise to existence, to this so-called game of God, of hide and seek. It's not a gut game of God. It's a game of God the Son. And the purpose is not just some enjoyable experience of waking up to what we are. The purpose is to like a research laboratory, to find the power of negation that can negate God the prime creator, that can negate reality the way it's set up, so that that God the Son can reset reality as it's in its own making, where it is prime creator now. That is the purpose of it. That completely changes your outlook, I believe. Everything suddenly makes sense. This nonsense that somehow God is responsible for this universe existence, for all this death and misery and impermanence and change, fragmentation, and awareness looking into all these mirrors, reflections of itself, and matter getting this fragmented reflection of itself. That's all some kind of game God is playing. That's totally untrue. The purpose, the reason why this is arising existence is very purposeful, is to present reflections to Spirit, to God the Son, which give false, negating evidence. Every time, everything you look at in this world is giving you false evidence of what you are. In other words, it's trying to showcase negation, trying to convince you that you can be negated. It's fragmented, it's changing, it's impermanent. Giving you false testimony about what you truly are. And all this false testimony is something that mind is projecting for Spirit. Mind is the servant of Spirit. Spirit tells mind, I want to be prime creator, so mind projects all of this, all of these reflections, all this matter that awareness is looking at, and giving these false reflections. That is the purpose, and all this is arising intentionally for the purpose of trying to develop, trying to find out, discovers the power of negation, something that can negate reality. And so we continually search in these reflections of fragmentation and negation, hoping to find that power. That is why we continue to remain fixated on existence. None of that is taught in non-dual teachings traditionally in the world. None of it. And paradoxically, it's a habit, a pattern of teaching that's going on. Even the great teachers like Ananda Maima would say, this world is a God playing a game, but it's a completely crazy game. She also say this world is just a lunatic asylum. But why would God be playing a completely insane game in a lunatic asylum? And then she would also say, everybody has to reach the death-free realm eventually. So, there is not a stability between these two statements. Fact is, God is not playing an insane game of hide-and-seek with itself. That is not God that's playing that game. That is all a projection from mind for the purpose that Spirit gave mind, the idea of trying to negate reality, the idea of trying to be prime creator. That is where it comes from. And this is a much better, clearer teaching in this area than non-dual teaching traditionally has given out. Much more clear. It truly answers the question instead of sidestepping the question of what's the purpose of life? Why is all this going on in the first place then? Why is awareness, addicted to all these mirrors, reflections of fragmentation? And where did all this fragmentation come from in the first place? And they just say, well, it's all just spontaneously arising. Nonsense. It's arising as a projection from mind to present images of fragmentation to God the Son. So God the Son is like creating, is like a research laboratory. Existence is a research laboratory where we are, God the Son is researching negation, carrying out all these experiments. Everything in this world is an experiment of God the Son to try and find some way to negate reality. None of this is taught in non-dual teaching. I've spent 55 years in this world constantly studying and searching for teachings that teach this. I can't find anything. Actually, the teachings of Jesus are actually much clearer about this, where he does clarify this to a certain extent, but it's been obscured. Talks about original sin. In other words, the origin of existence is sin or negation. It's the very origin of it. And that existence is a deceiver, a liar, and a murderer from the very beginning. In other words, existence is engaged in the effort to find a power of negation, which is why everything here is killed, destroyed, dissolved, negated. Those are all experiments in negation. God the Father, God the Prime Creator, had nothing to do with any of this. He's not playing a game of hide and seek with itself. That is totally false. Never happened. God the Father is perfectly, eternally aware of its true nature. And all of existence is not some kind of wonderful experience that will go on forever. We're supposed to just enjoy all this game. Not true at all. It's simply one simple, stupid idea that we had of trying to be Prime Creator. There's an infinity of other ideas in reality that we can choose from. They have nothing to do with trying to negate anything. Therefore, all this false mirrors, reflections of matter don't need to arise at all. All other ideas in reality don't have anything to do with energy or matter or form. Any of that has to do all with essence. And there's no negation possible with essence at all. It's pure idea, pure essence, pure isness. It has nothing to do with change, with nature, with dynamics, with energy. Nothing whatsoever to do with that. Reality is not that way at all. It's a very important topic because I just non-stop reinforcement in this world of the false notion that somehow this is all God's handiwork. Not true. By saying that, we are literally defending against the truth and keeping ourselves fixated with this ridiculous game of negation, this ridiculous research experiment that we're carrying out, trying to find some power of negation that will actually work. We'll never find it. So we say, as long as we're trying to find it, we'll be stuck in this research lab, believing that we are vulnerable. We have some sort of type of vulnerability. The fact is, we don't. Reality has no vulnerability whatsoever. And yet here, these ridiculous meat suits that we wear, which are nothing but forms of vulnerability. These meat suits are vulnerable to everything. Incredibly vulnerable. And how can anyone believe that God, the Prime Creator, the eternal source of eternal life, manifested all this for some cosmic joke of hide and seek? Manifested all this vulnerability. Just look in the physician's desk reference, various medical publications that show all the different diseases. They're infinite. The body is subject to unbelievable amount of vulnerability and destruction and sickness and suffering and harm. You'd have to conclude that the body was custom made to suffer, to experience all different forms of negation. And the fact is, that's exactly what the body was created for, was manifested for, was projected by mind for. It wasn't created, it's a projection, psychic projection of imagination. It was projected because the body is capable of manifesting a massive array of sicknesses and diseases and types of death. Much more sophisticated than plants, for instance. Plants can get some kind of fungus, some kind of beetle infection. You know, it can die in various ways. But the body, human body, that's why we're told the body is so important, you know. Oh, it's so important. God created this special body, blah, blah, blah. No, the body is important to this research experiment because it's subject to so many different types of negation. And therefore, we find it very valuable. We're very interested in the body because we say, wow, this body can die in so many different ways. It can get sick, so many different types of sickness. You know, we know a lot of the traditional ones, but if you dig into the medical research, you will find an unbelievable amount of troubles that the body can have. Truly, it will blow your mind. And I've done this. I've looked at all the different sicknesses and diseases. It's endless. Almost endless. There's many more constantly coming up, too. And of course, any viruses, all these different viruses can come at any moment. It's a new virus. New recombinant virus, you know. And, you know, there's something that the amoeba, you know, will come in and eat your brain. You know, just endless. And so we glorify the body and claim it comes from God merely to keep our research going. Saying this all came from God is a way to believe that we have no choice but to remain fixated on this. It's one of the most severe defenses possible. If it came from God, how can we have any power to escape it? We can't. Or if it did come from God, then God also gives us the power to escape it, and God must be a lunatic. Why would we want to return to such a God that created such a monstrosity as existence? Of course it's tinged with beauty, because we're researching on how to negate reality. So we have to make something that seems beautiful to us, that we can at least believe is reality. You know, it's a facsimile, or we can at least think, well, if we can destroy this, then we can probably destroy reality. So we have to make it seem tinged with some kind of beauty, so it seems believable at all. That's why we ornament the body, try to make the body beautiful, and then it dies. And we think, well, look at something so beautiful and noble has died. Now, that must mean that some negation had some power over reality. We claim that God created bodies, and then, of course, all bodies die. We think, well, gee, what God makes must be vulnerable to being destroyed. And therefore, we know that God creates, extends itself. So then if what God extended can be destroyed, then God itself must be able to be destroyed. So none of these things are ever taught in non-dual teachings. They're not taught anywhere in this world. It's ridiculous. This is ABC 1, 2, 3. This is the basic, simple teaching. It's being completely overlooked. And we're just being taught, just be aware, you know, just be the pure awareness, drop all the mirrors. That's fine. That's very fine and good. It's not the complete teaching. That's why it seems that people come up short in this planet. Spiritual teaching here is not good. And so very, very few, really, truly get it. And for some reason, when they do, they need to cater to those who come to see them. So they keep saying this is all God's play. That is the heart of nonsense. Very, very causes problems, tremendous problems. Like I said, who in the world could trust a God that created such an insane play? Can't trust such a God. It'd be impossible to trust such a God. Of course, everything is arising awareness. So that's like saying everything that you see on the television set is being seen on the screen of the television set. So what? And the question is, well, is the television set producing what shows on it, or is what's showing on the screen producing the television set? The answer is neither. It's not one or the other. It's neither. So it's important, very crucially important, as we are now living in a fascistic planet, which is a horrible, horrible system. And it's only going to get exponentially worse, that you realize you have the authority over this dream entirely. You don't have authority to tell the dream how to function. You have the authority to choose whether you want to experience this dream or experience some other idea. Whether you want to experience the effects of this idea, of trying to find negation, or try to choose a different idea. You have the authority. God didn't choose this idea. You chose it. Spirit chose it. Therefore, you have the right and authority to choose a different idea. God created spirit to choose ideas, to play with ideas. Therefore, spirit has the sovereign authority to do that. Doesn't have to remain fixated on one idea and then try to rationalize this fixation as God created all this, so this is the realm of play within the effects of the idea of negation, trying to play within those effects, guaranteed to be a mixed bag. They'll be up and down and around. You'll seem to have good times and bad times. It's a mixed bag at best, and always ends with negation, with your death, with the death of that which you're identifying with the experimental subject that you're following. This meat suit is an experimental subject that you're following with interest to see how is it going to be killed. How's it going to die? That's what we're really following. To say that what we are is just pure consciousness is not true. That's like saying what we are is the television set or the screen of the television, who's completely uninterested in what's being shown on the screen. It's true that the screen is uninterested, but that is not what we are. We're very interested in what's taking place here because we're trying to find a power of negation so we can be prime creators. So that's why we're interested in it. Sure, it's all rising in what we call awareness. It's like saying that everything on the television is arising on the screen. So what? It's not important. That's just a functionality. That's how it's being presented to us on a screen of awareness. Awareness is just a screen where we experience, where we experience the ideas. Mind presents ideas. Spirit chooses ideas. Mind presents ideas. Consciousness or awareness is just a screen that the idea is being presented on. But we, spirit, are not the screen. We're not awareness. We are beyond. We're greater. We have interest. We are the great adventurer, the great experiencer, the great player. We have interest. We have interest in this idea. And yet we deny this interest. We claim this is all just arising mysteriously, spontaneously. It all comes from God. That's all nonsense. It's arising from the dynamic, from the desire to find the power of negation. That is what is propelling all these arisings. Everything that arises in existence arises for the purpose of negation as an experimental subject. There's no mystery to it. Bodies are born. Everything is born so that it can die. That's a fact. Of course we follow all these births with interest because we want to see how is it, how is negation going to play with this form? I tell you, this is the absolute truth. Even it has to do with planets. You can be interested in a planet, but ultimately your interest is how is negation going to play with this planet and bring it down eventually. Same with identifying with a person. Same thing. Identifying with a country. Whatever you identify with in existence, you're identifying with it because you want to see how the play of negation is going to play with this and eventually bring it down. Destroy it. It's a play of construction and destruction, but the purpose, the interest is, how is negation going to play with this? And of course, if there's nothing constructed, if there's no meat suit born, there's nothing for negation to play with. So of course, existence has this massive amount of constructivity, nonstop reproduction, producing forms. All of that is done so that then spirit can follow these forms and see how negation plays with them and how negation destroys them, decays them, makes them sick, diseased, some way negates them. That's the purpose of existence. It's a research project spirit is carrying out, trying to find a power of negation. I have to keep saying this over and over because there's no other teaching I can point you to that points this out. It's crazy in this world. The lack of really clear, high-level teaching here is just amazing. And even the people who go to the gurus and teachers non-dual, you know, they don't seem to want to know what the purpose really is. I know a lot of them ask that question, you know, why? Why is all this misery and suffering? Why are we go through all of this? And they never get a clear answer. Why? The answer is very simple, very easy, very clear. It needs to be presented here. But truly, the lack of presenting this in this world is so extreme that you have to realize spirit is intensely interested in how negation is going to play with this world. It doesn't want to drop this experiment. therefore it doesn't want to really hear the truth here in this world. That's what I have discovered. People come to this world, or rather spirit identifies with all this constructivity in this world because it's really interested to see how negation plays with all these meat suits here, how it plays with the globe, countries, the ecosystems, how destructivity works here. And of course, spirit also is interested in the new constructivity and how negation will play with that new constructivity. It's very fascinated by this still. So you don't have interest in actually seeing what's taking place here, really seeing it. It's a cop-out to say, well, it's just all awareness, it's just all rising in awareness. That leaves out the one who is watching the television program. What is their interest in watching it? And why is the content the way that it is? There's a purpose behind that content. Not just spontaneously arising in awareness. That's no explanation at all. That's a lack of explanation. There's a reason why when you watch television, you see all this violence and all this terrible stuff on television. Horrible. It's purpose. It's purposeful. Producers are purposely producing that. And you're watching it because you're purposely interested in it. It's not just spontaneously arising. If you've ever produced movies, you know how much work goes into it. It's an extraordinary amount of work. Every last detail is planned ahead of in advance. It's all choreographed. And all the editing, everything is done to present very, very purposeful what you're watching. The soundtracks are very cleverly carried out, very purposeful. Presenting negation, much of it, okay? And the reason why you're watching is you're very interested in negation. The reason why people are so attracted to all the bad news. You know, if it bleeds, it leads, because everybody's very interested, meaning spirit is very interested in negation, fascinated by it. And so it doesn't want to listen to any teachings that point out what's really going on that might lead to it dropping this research experiment. It's so invested in succeeding, it doesn't realize it cannot succeed. Only after it seems like suffering gets so severe, the spirit has to finally re-examine the entire situation as it finally reached the truth and realized, you know, I'm projecting all of this. Mind is doing it for me. Mind, my servant, is projecting all this for me, for strictly for the purpose of trying to find some power of negation so I can negate God, the prime creator, and I can sit on the throne of creation. I'll be the prime creator. That is the entire purpose of it all. And the real remedy is what I call repentance, which is to go to, spirit needs to go to God, the prime creator. The son needs to go to the father, the prodigal son, return to the father, the home of the father, and say, you know what? This is what I tried to do. I realize it's impossible to negate you, to negate reality, and I don't want to do it anymore. I realize it's futile, so I want to drop it. And God, the prime creator, will say, wonderful. Just choose the idea of non-negation, and you'll experience this seamless peace. And that'll rehabilitate you to so that you'll be able to choose all other ideas and play the way you're meant to play, in essence, in freedom and in essence. That's the solution. Repentance is the solution, is the cure. But first you have to be honest. You can't just sidestep and say, well, this is all God's play, some crazy play that God is just trying to experience all different diversities, you know. That's another line that's used, that God is doing this simply to experience everything, all different things. Every type of happiness, every type of suffering, every type of sickness, every type of poverty, destitution, and in-between, and boredom. God just wants to experience all these different things. That is total nonsense. Guarantee you that poverty and suffering and sickness is horrible. These ideas must come from some kind of bourgeois, you know, sensibilities. I don't know why anyone who's really suffered could possibly think that. Poverty is a horrible thing. It's a grinding, stressful, death-like state of suffering and misery and fear. Horrible. Fear of destitution, starving to death, of freezing to death, being out on the streets. I've seen so many people. It's horrible. Completely incompatible with a truly eternal God of eternal life. all of existence, again, I say, it comes from just one little tiny crazy idea. I'm trying to find the power of negation. All this suffering and poverty, destitution, you see, again, is an experiment on forms. On these meat suits, on these constructs we call life, wrongly call life. These are simply experimental subjects that are being experimented on to see how the negation plays with it. You see the person, the homeless person there, only way they can stay alive is constantly drinking alcohol. I give some money to them, what do? They go to a store and buy alcohol and drink it, try to kill the pain, kill the suffering, kill the misery. You look into their eyes and you see that they're a son of God just like you, but they're fascinated with this play of negation, and they're seeing how negation is playing with their meat suit, with their body, with their emotions, with all the constructs they've identified with. They're watching it. They're watching their own death and misery and suffering. Are they enjoying it? No. They hate it. It's terrible. They feel frightened, very frightened. Terrible fear that somehow they're being annihilated, you know. It's awful. So many of these teachings come from what I say upper middle class educated people who really think, you know, life's a bowl of cherries. If you really put yourself and see the misery of this world like I have, you won't talk this way at all, that this is all just a crazy play of God, you know. That's just insane to say that. It's a crazy play for sure. It's worse than that. It's an attempt to develop a form of negation that can negate reality. So all this insane suffering and misery, you go into retirement homes and assisted living places, you see hellacious lives in there of every kind of mania and dementia, and lives just, you know, torn up into shreds, people so fragmented, horrible things, and on so much medication. All of that is they're trying to develop a form of negation that can negate reality. So they're using these meat suits as a test subjects and saying, I wonder if this hideous form of attack on this body can be utilized to attack reality. That is why we're suffering. That is why all this is happening. Very simple to step out of this. We just choose a different idea. We say, I don't want to be prime creator. I don't want to try and be prime creator. I want to be what I am, how God created me as a son of God, and play with the infinite sea of wonderful ideas. Repent, and you don't need to continue on your research with negation. You don't need to identify with the meat suit that's going to be put through the ringer, through the grinder of existence, and come up with some hideous demise. You don't need to starve to death. You don't need to be put in re-education camps and starve to death. You don't need to be attacked. You don't need any of that because you're no longer researching negation. You can sidestep it all. Take spiritual sanctuary. Choose repentance, and therefore you will have the opportunity for spiritual sanctuary in the death-free realms, meaning there's places that are based on different ideas. The idea of not trying to negate reality can manifest places. Mind can manifest places. There's no negation there. No death, no sickness, no dying, no negation, because there's no research being carried out on how to find a power of negation. Instead, there's just this incredible blanket of pure peacefulness. Infinite depth to it. That is what all of us can have, very simply and very easily, by deciding to repent. Be honest. Say, this is what I tried to do. I've been trying to find a power of negation to negate reality, to negate God, the prime creator. I realize that's folly, it's foolish, had no effect, I can never succeed. I want to choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator. And then, right then, you repent. Like Jesus said to the thief on the cross, you'll be with me in paradise. Just like that. That simple. Clean, simple, easy repentance. Choose a different idea. You are a citizen of the death-free realms. You escape the fascistic, horrible new world order of this planet and all the negation that will take place here. If you don't do that, it's because you're fascinated with the play of negation and how it's going to play out here. You're fascinated with it. with the revolutions, with the deposing of dictators, with the wars that'll happen, with the famines, with the pestilence, with the global catastrophes. All these things, you know, it's a train wreck. It's the most incredible train wreck is going to happen on this planet that's, you know, almost ever been seen in the universe. That is why there's so many people here, so many extraterrestrials here. They're all viewing this planet, and they all tell us, oh, they're here because there's some incredible ascension, most beautiful ascension that's ever happened. That is not true. They are here. That's a cover story because they're dishonest. The fact is they are here to witness this massive train wreck of negation because they're fascinated to see how negation is going to play out here on this planet at this time with 7 billion meat suits on it. Research subjects, 7 billion research subjects, humans, all the birds, all the plants, all the animals, all the topography, all the ecosystems, everything here is a massive amount of constructivity here for negation to play with. And that is why all the extraterrestrials are here, if they're honest about it, which they're not. They claim they're just here benevolently to witness this incredible ascension of the planet becoming some jewel. It is complete nonsense. That's self-deception. It's a refusal to repent and be honest about existence. So I have to say these things because nobody else is saying them. It's ridiculous. There should be many teachers teaching this here, but nobody wants to teach it here. Very, very, very unfortunate because spirit is still so fascinated with negation. I'm no longer fascinated with it. Of course, there's still some interest in it, yeah. But I just assume not be interested in it. I've seen too much. I've suffered too much. I've seen the horrors. I've researched it. I realize what this planet's really about, the atrocities, the genocides, the nonstop dying, the sickness, old age, every kind of dashed hope and dream of young people, of old people, everything. It's a meat grinder. It's a grinder, like a washing machine of negation, just tearing you this way and that. It's ridiculous. You don't have to continue to be fascinated with this. That's why I'm saying choose a different idea. Expect that you can relocate. Take spiritual asylum. Take spiritual sanctuary. Relocate to a death-free realm. Put your will there. Put your intent. Put your honesty there. Remember, repentance is higher than enlightenment. Because the enlightenment that's being taught in this world leaves out repentance, which is a direct experience with God, the prime creator, where you're directly aware in the presence of God, the prime creator, and there's a reconciliation that takes place there. There's an honesty, and you're purged of your dishonesty, of your deceit, and all of that is no longer necessary to carry on that charade. I can talk this way because I've been in the presence of God, the prime creator. I'm not afraid of God, the prime creator. So I'm not hiding anything or trying to deceive God, the prime creator. So I'm just speaking directly. I say, yeah, of course, this is what I've been. I chose the idea of trying to develop a power of negation over reality. And that's all. And God says, yeah, of course you did. You're right. That you're being honest. That's great. So now you're free to choose a different idea. No longer trying to hide this fact of authorship. We are the author of all this, not God the prime creator, okay? God the prime creator didn't create death, didn't create sickness, didn't even create forms at all. These forms, organic forms, did not create those. God the prime creator creates through pure idea, pure essence. So put your mind on just very simple honesty, repentance. You can do it. There's no anger at all in God, the prime creator, because no harm, no foul. You've done nothing to harm reality. You've never developed a form of negation that has the slightest effect on reality. Just in spite of identifying with many research subjects, many meat suits have died over and over and over again from all different ways, having your head chopped off, starving to death, dying of typhus, dying of cholera, smallpox, cancer, being strangled to death, being crushed, You know, all different ways, all different afflictions. Wasting away from something, leukemia, who knows why. I did so many, many different subjects, research subjects you'd identified with. None of those negations of those research subjects, those meat suits, has had the slightest effect on developing anything that can harm reality. So you've done nothing to succeed in your quest to harm reality. Nothing at all. So you don't have any guilt. In God's eyes, you're sinless. You got no guilt. You have no guilt. So you don't need to atone for anything. You've not done anything to reality. You don't need any forgiveness. You haven't done anything. You don't need to be forgiven. God's not there saying, well, I forgive you for what you did. You didn't do anything. You don't need to atone for anything. You've not harmed reality in the slightest bit. So all you need to do is just come in and say, yeah, God, I know I haven't harmed you in the slightest way. I'm going to give this effort up. So help me out with that. I just want to choose a different idea. It's that simple. That's all there is to it. And yet our fascination with negation, you know, continues. It's okay, because it's having no effect, never will. We don't have to be perfectly disinterested in it. Like I said, I still have some vague interest in it occasionally, you know. Some news, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, oh, that's interesting, huh? Okay, whatever. Boring, boring, boring. It's boring. But there's still a little bit of interest. That's okay. It doesn't matter. All you need is that basic honesty. Trust to just go to God, the Prime Creator, and say, hey, that's it. I know what I did now. I know I've been trying to fool myself, deceive myself, claim that you're the one responsible for everything I did. I know it's not true. I want to end it. I want to stop it. I want to choose a different idea. I want to get back to functioning the way I was created to function instead of trying to negate reality. That's ridiculous. I want to get back to my true treasures. And God will say, oh, that's great. But I recommend you get this intermediate step of choosing the idea of not trying to negate reality and maintain the continuity with all these research forms that you've projected, mine is projected for you. But now you see this perfect peace. Or even better, you can go to a death-free realm where all these forms are still there, but they're an immaculate, perfect, non-negated condition eternally. You look at a tree, and the tree is timeless. It's been there for eternity. It's never been harmed. Everything you see in the death-free realms seems eternal. It's always been there. It's never been harmed. And yet you see like a pine tree. You see the pine tree and say, oh, it looks like a pine tree. It's a nice pine tree. It looks just like the pine trees I see in this world. But then you look at it more carefully and you realize, this pine tree seems a little bit different in some way. And then you look at it more carefully and you say, my gosh, there's no evidence of harm on this tree whatsoever. And it seems like this tree has always been that way, will always be that way. That's the difference with the death-free realms, is that the forms are still there. The trees, the plants, the ground, the water, the sky, etc. But it's an immaculate, perfect condition, and you see, it's always been that way. You look at this shrub, this flower, and the flower's always been blooming there. Always will continue to bloom, be in that perfect condition. You say, wow, I love this. This is wonderful. It has a wonderful effect. You love it. Your spirit just loves it. Spirit doesn't love negation. It hates negation. It's only using this research experiment on negation as a means to an end. But spirit hates existence. It wants to finish the job, find a power of negation, and negate reality, and then be prime creator. It doesn't want to keep on with this ridiculous negation, all these dyings and sicknesses and deaths. It hates this stuff. So when spirit experiences the death-free realms, spirit loves it. It says, wow, this is exactly what I love. Eternal life, no negation. Wonderful. There you go. Okay. That's enough chat for right now. Had a great time chatting with you here, and do some more in the future. That's it.